All right. Nick Verner and Parky Prim. And we're going to get a special guest joining us in the booth here momentarily. And I might be able to tell us a little bit about both of these players here. Well, we know Nick Verner here, Hall of Famer. And we're going to have joining us right now, coach of the Lindenwood Lions, Mr. Mark Wilson. Mark, welcome to the show, sir.
Hey, Ray. Glad to be here. Hello, everybody. We've got a great match going on here. Couldn't be more excited about the whole thing.
Now, tell us about, is it Karki?
Prim Karki.
Prim Karki.
Yeah.
So, last name Karki?
Yep.
Okay. All right. We'll get that corrected here.
He hails from Nepal, the pride in Nepal, second best player in Nepal, as a matter of fact.
No kidding.
Beavor, the best player in Nepal, couldn't make it today. But
he's also on your
team?
Yeah,
we have two players from Nepal.
And wow.
Believe it or not, one of the slopes of Mount Everest is in Nepal. This is all I've learned about geography is from where my kids hail from. But right. Also, they have seen tigers in the wild, Ray. Think
really?
Of that. Yeah.
Wow.
The key thing is you never run. You always hide.
That's right. Sounds like good advice.
Yeah. A great matchup here, Nick Verner, former national collegiate billiards champion, two times.
That's right. You know, and there's only a handful of players that have won that twice, isn't there?
Yeah, there's only a couple. There's three that won it three times, a couple that won it twice. Current pros, Nick Verner and Max Eberle, I know, have both won it twice.
And a three-time winner, I believe, is Raymond Linares from down in Florida.
Yeah, the other three-time winners was one of my pool students. I'm not taking credit for success because he was just a great player, but Lars Vardaman.
That's right, Lars.
And then the third one.
Pharmacist now, isn't that correct?
The third player that won it was back in the 40s, Leroy Kinman, and I played him in a straight pool tournament once.
No kidding.
Not knowing that that was where his origins stemmed from. Over here on the other table, we have Shane McMinn and Stephen Wyatt playing.
Well, I had the pleasure of stopping over at, this is for the viewers out there, over at Lindenwood University, and had an opportunity to see firsthand some of the drills and some of the procedures and the way you all operate over at Lindenwood University. I was really impressed with the program.
Yeah, we're proud of what's going on here. We train as scientifically as we possibly can when they come there. You know, naturally, number one is education to be a member of the Billiards team. We want you to get good grades, so I ask that you maintain a 3.0, and the school really only mandates a 2.5. And then you have to be a person of good character and understand our core values, how we operate, and respect the sport. And thirdly, I'll make you a good player if you're going to stay 4 years with us. So we have players of all skill sets. We have players from entry level all the way up to what I consider to be low-end pros presently on the team. We have about 30 team members. The school supports it first class, and Ray can testify that we have a first-class arena that they custom-built. It's almost a year old now.
Yeah, it's amazing. Really nice, well-kept. Great environment to learn the game in.
Prem has a little bit of a snooker background, so when I met him, he already had some experience at snooker, not hardly any at pool, but he's a very serious young man, works hard on his game. I'm certain this is the biggest match he's ever played in his life, so I'm sure there's adrenaline's coursing through his veins. I've got some electricity here.
And do you all work with the players on how to deal with that mm-hmm. adrenaline?
We do. We have the Lindenwood shooting system, and whenever you're nervous, uncertain, lack of confidence, you rely upon those chosen, selected ideals of stroke mechanics. It's pretty interesting, and we encourage that. We reinforce it every practice, and then right before we came in here today, we talked about what we were doing. Great shot there by Nick Verner. Great shot.
Yeah, sure was. The cue ball tried to trickle out from behind the six ball there. I think Nick had intended to stick it right on the six ball. He still came out okay.
Yeah, it was a great job. He was at an awkward angle to make that hit. He had to land pretty heavy on the object ball. you know, when you talk about all-around talents of the sport, you have to include Nick Varner's name if you include the disciplines, the various disciplines. And if you didn't include his name, you would just be wrong. That's all there is to it.
Absolutely. Great one-pocket player. Great nine-ball player. Great all-around player, right?
Let's talk about Banks and straight pool. There's nobody going to beat him at those either.
That's right. That's right.
Now, I don't know about his billiards game, but I suspect that would be good too. And you know what? He does it with tenacity. He thinks his shots through. He's not got the prettiest stroke mechanics that you've ever seen, but he has the guy. He's the guy that wants to win worse than the other guy and will work hard.
Right.
To you know, always at the tournament, you always see him up hitting balls and practicing. Always admired that about Nick's game. His diligence. A dedicated craftsman.
Really great person too. Nick's always on the front lines of helping anyone.
Well, helping the sport by attending this event 2 years in a row. So,
that's right.
I mean, that says it all. He gives back to the college level, and don't think my kids weren't super excited to possibly play against the Hall of Famer.
If someone listening out there maybe wanted to try to get their college or their university to get involved in a program, what would you recommend? I mean, how as far as approaching them? I know you were approached by Lindenwood, which is, that's rare, though. That's rare that a college would do that.
Yeah, I think still there's, you know, the old, some of the resistance to the sport really being a sport. They think of it as a game. And, you know, based on the fact that oftentimes it's played in bar rooms with smoke and beer, it kind of lends itself to the wrong element. But if many of the schools already have facilities that are underutilized, but they really don't have anyone there to kind of motivate the thing.
Yeah, and a lot have, like, just clubs. They have, like, pool clubs instead of an actual, like, team.
Yeah, at the best. I mean, usually a club is just two or three players that like it. So it really takes someone that really, you got to be kind of willing to sacrifice to make it happen. You got to love the sport. But if we did have some of those dedicated people, I know the colleges would be on board if they really took a good look at the program. And now that we have kind of a pilot program here to look at, I certainly understand a lot more about it. Okay, Shay McMinn has now won this set over Stephen Wyatt.
No kidding. Wow, he came back from behind. And, Shane is a grinder.
Yeah, that was a good win. He was down 2-0. And we now have Jaden Hergott coming up on the secondary table.
Mark, I believe we have had a score here already. And I still have the score at 0, or perhaps they have not.
No,
still,
opening rack.
Still first rack. Players are keeping track of their games with coins. Thank you. back and we'll look, get the score updated here. I believe Nick Varner may be up 1-0. You know what? Actually, I think he did not mark his game there. And I believe it is 1-1. Nice bank from Nick there. Once again, joining us, Mark Wilson here, a coach of the Lindenwood Billiard Team. And this is your host, Ray Hansen. We're back live from the Durbin Farms here in central Illinois.
Yep, we're playing some nine ball today. And Nick Varner was trailing 1-0, and his opponent was shooting the nine. Prem was shooting the nine, missed it. Nick stepped up, rifled in a great bank shot, tied the match up, broke, made a ball, and now he's got a killer safety down. That's the kind of turnaround you have when you play a Hall of Famer. A missed shot like that can cost you 2 or 3 games, you know, which would be the whole set in this case.
Now Nick has got him locked down.
He's going to need top spin is not the greatest way to go at this one. But he was able to hit it, so that being the case, I thought he needed to shorten it up a little bit more.
There's no easy shot here for Nick. Little tester. He'll likely go over into the side rail just above the side pocket here and back out just a touch for the three ball. Take a long shot of the three ball.
Yeah, that would seem to be the shrewd play. Minimize cue ball travel. Take what you have. That's what the table wants to give you. Beautiful. But it was a nice pace that gave himself a little bit of extra accuracy there. When you feel that first shot of each inning, your arm's a little shaky. You want to make sure you get the ball down. Let the cue ball drift out to the center of the table, the most valuable position area on the entire table.
All right, and right here, he's got the entire table. He's okay on, but he would like to be below the line from the four ball to the corner pocket. He would like to be below that line. Just a hair if possible so he can avoid the 8-ball. But it's not the end of the world if he comes off the 8-ball, is it?
No, and the main thing is don't miss the 3 trying to be cute and preserve the right angle there. It's not really, it's a little bit thin for the shot, and I think he's feeling uncomfortable about trying to slow roll this. So. Get a lot of experience here with Nick Varner, very savvy veteran. Yeah, played it with a nice pace. He is going to have to deal with the 8-ball, but made sure he made the 3. That's always a good decision. Make sure you make the ball. 1-1 is their score. Big rack here.
Yeah, it looks like he could use the 8-ball. The edge of the 8-ball here just has kind of like a pseudo rail. And come off the 8-ball into the bottom rail and back up towards the 5. Doesn't really have to have a lot of angle on this 5-ball.
What a nice shot that was. Well played, well controlled.
Right back out to the center of the table.
Looking at whether they're trying to hold the cue ball for 1 cushion position or 2 cushion position. He now goes across the table to see about playing the 6 in the far long corner pocket. Comes out for the side pocket. Well done.
I Well, there are a lot of players may have just floated straight over and played the shot in the bottom left corner there. And Nick's route here seems like he took the, made sure he had an easier shot on a six ball by coming around and playing for the side pocket.
Yeah, it wasn't so much the shot on the six ball. He wasn't worried about making it in the corner, but that led him to position easier transfer. If he fell funny or straight on the six, he wouldn't have to draw it. So by getting out here, it allowed him to get on the eight ball a little bit easier. Good shot. Falls perfectly on the nine. Hits the heart of the pocket. And now the missed nine ball is now turned into two games the other way. As Nick's capitalized. And that's what an unforced error does in pro pool. Oftentimes it accumulates two or three games.
Or more.
Your opponent back in.
Yeah. Well, any updates on what the current score is between the teams?
As it stands right now, Lindenwood has four matches, and the Durbin Destroyers have two. This is a race to 17 matches out of 32. We'll be playing all 32 matches, no matter what the score is, however.
Nice.
Yeah. Okay, 2-1 for Varner. Prem Karkai breaking. Good break. Successful break. Three ball kisses the one out. Like the seven ball is going to cover the cue ball, which it did, so we'll be seeing a push out from here.
This is a tough one, too. Where do you like pushing out here, Mark?
Well, with Nick Varner, I mean, if there's any way to tie up some balls and try to prolong the game, which is still not going to be necessarily a winning strategy, I just try to prolong it. But yeah, you have to push out two rails. This is a hard push out, really. You got to get the cue ball clear on the other end of the table and try to hope that you don't leave a on-angle bank.
Right.
Eight ball's kind of in the way. Tricky, tricky, tricky situation.
I'm curious to see what Prem is going to come up with here.
Well, he's not calling push out. Yes, he is. He may have scratched on this. Nope. Good. Yeah, well done. It was actually a good shot just for a push out. He had to make a good shot.
Yeah, he sure did.
He left the on angle bank, though. Nick will accept this because he can tuck the cue ball underneath the two. And if the one ball finds the pocket, he's got to play on the two. If it doesn't, he's going to leave it very difficult for Prem. No risk, just tuck the cue ball away. Well done. Makes me want to applaud here, even though I'm the coach of Lindenwood. That was a great shot. That was a lesson right there, really. Yeah. Hope my players were watching. On the adjacent table here, John Gabriel broke, made the nine on the break, but that returns to the table. It just counts as a ball down. You do not win or lose on the nine ball on the break. Ray, these matches are going to end up on YouTube?
Yes.
Well, that's the great thing about this. Now my players can go back and look, and when they see the shot that Nick Varner just played right there, now you know why he's in the Hall of Fame. Analyzed it, didn't take too much risk. He could have banked at the one. He already made a great bank in this match.
Right. The two ball wasn't real big to hide behind there. Right. If he had trickled out and left a shot, he may have sold out the game.
In these little short races to three, you can't be giving up open innings, you know, so this was very heady. And he's got the upper hand in this right here. He just needs one game to collect the match. Prem's got the jump cue out. Oh, good job. Good job. He made a legal hit. He's left a shot, but that's all he could do from there. And Varner has earned another good opening here with his stellar safety play. Yeah, that's courtesy of the Gold Crown 5 Tour Edition with super snug pockets in there. So he did not hit that ball bad.
These tables come from the factory with 4.5-inch pockets.
Yeah, beautiful setup here. This arena is unbelievable here at Durbin's Q Factory, isn't it?
Yes, it's beautiful.
Who would imagine? I've known Nick for a lot of years and always admired his game and his composure. And you know, in Efren's prime, nobody went to the Philippines and beat Efren Reyes in a long set except for Nick Varner.
No kidding.
Yep. Wow. Beat him a three-day set. Yeah, it was a very, very interesting match.
I know Efren has a lot of respect for Nick.
Bad luck there. That was a heck of a try at the nine.
Well, I take it the one must not have went in. I thought he had the one. He could have spun the cue ball off the end rail and made that one ball.
He may have been trying that, hit it too heavy. And much like you alluded to earlier, he's a bit nervous in this match. I'm not sure. It's hard to tell from our angle because we're so low, but it may have been making room. Okay. Yep. On the other match, we have... John Gabriel has just collected the win, so the score now in the entire match is 4 for Lindenwood, 3 for the Destroyers.
Going to do a quick rundown here of the players that are playing on each team here.
And for the Lindenwood Lions, we have Shariq Syed, one of our team leaders.
Where is Shariq from?
He's from Singapore. Okay. Came here exclusively for the billiards program.
Mm-hmm.
And he's a 4.0 honors student. Got the Presidential Scholarship Award, which is really a cool thing. And then we have Tanner Nichols. He's from the middle of Missouri. Landon Shuffett hails from Kentucky. He's the current reigning men's national collegiate billiards champion.
Yeah, very impressive getting man.
Right behind him, we have Brianna Miller, and she's the current women's national champion. She's from Pennsylvania. Then we have Stephen Wyatt from Kentucky, Drake Niepater from Albers, Illinois, Prem Karkai from Nepal. He's playing Nick Varner here in front of us now. And then Jaden Hargott from Minnesota. On the opposition's team, they are led by Nick Varner. You don't have to say much about him. Hall of Famer. John Gabriel from Oklahoma. Pro player. Great player.
Our host.
Our host. The namesake here. Who's now playing a match against Shariq.
Mike Durbin. Great cues also, by the way.
Great person. And we have...
You've been playing with Mike's cues for quite a few years, haven't you?
Sure have, yeah. And does a tremendous job and willing to try new things. Always pioneering new ways to make the cues better.
Yeah, that's awesome.
They're very performance-oriented. They're cosmetically beautiful, but he doesn't overdo that part of it if it mitigates the performance characteristics of the cue. So I always admired that about him.
Yeah, I'm anxious to hit a few balls with one. I've never hit with one.
Then we have Chuck Ralston.
No, Chuck was in the, played in the Junior Nationals also. Did Chuck win a Junior Nationals? I can't recall. It's
caught me off guard there. I'm not sure if he did or didn't. I know he's played in all these.
Yeah, it's been 10 or 12 years since that.
Nick Varner closes out the match. The other players would be Shane McMinn from Oklahoma and Dustin Wilgus from here in Champaign, Illinois. So they got a formidable lineup.
Yeah, they got a solid team.
And so,
all right, we're going to get that one saved, Mark. Thanks for those rosters. And we'll be back with another match here momentarily. Looks like, well, we'll announce who we're going to have here in just a moment. Don't go away, folks.
Yeah, Chuck and Tanner.
Nick Varner and Parky Prem, and we're going to get a special guest joining us in the booth here momentarily, and I might be able to tell us a little bit about both of these players here. Well, we know Nick Varner here, Hall of Famer, and we're going to have joining us right now, coach of the Lindenwood Lions, Mr. Mark Wilson. Mark, welcome to the show, sir.
Hey, Ray. Glad to be here. Hello, everybody. We've got a great match going on here. Couldn't be more excited about the whole thing.
Now, tell us about, is it Karki?
Prem Karki.
Prem Karki.
Yeah.
So, last name Karki?
Yep.
Okay. All right. We'll get that corrected here.
He hails from Nepal, the pride in Nepal, second best player in Nepal, as a matter of fact.
No kidding.
Beavor, the best player in Nepal, couldn't make it today. But
He's also on your
team?
Yeah,
we have two players from Nepal.
Wow.
Believe it or not, one of the slopes of Mount Everest is in Nepal. This is all I've learned about geography is from where my kids hail from. But right. Also, they have seen tigers in the wild, Ray. Think
really?
Of that. Yeah.
Wow.
The key thing is you never run. You always hide.
That's right. Sounds like good advice.
Yeah. A great matchup here, Nick Varner, former national collegiate billiards champion, two times.
That's right. You know, and there's only a handful of players that have won that twice, isn't there?
Yeah, there's only a couple. There's three that won it three times, a couple that won it twice. Current pros, Nick Varner and Max Eberle, I know, have both won it twice.
And a three-time winner, I believe, is Raymond Linares from down in Florida.
Yeah, the other three-time winners was one of my pool students. I'm not taking credit for success because he was just a great player, but Lars Vardaman.
That's right, Lars.
And then the third one.
Pharmacist now, isn't that correct?
The third player that won it was back in the 40s, Leroy Kinman, and I played him in a straight pool tournament once.
No kidding.
Not knowing that that was where his origins stemmed from. Over here on the other table, we have Shane McMinn and Stephen Wyatt playing.
Well, I've had the pleasure of stopping over at, this is for the viewers out there, over at Lindenwood University, and had an opportunity to see firsthand some of the drills and some of the procedures and the way you all operate over at Lindenwood University. I was really impressed with the program.
Yeah, we're proud of what's going on here. We train as scientifically as we possibly can when they come there. You know, naturally, number one is education to be a member of the Billiards team. We want you to get good grades, so I ask that you maintain a 3.0, and the school really only mandates a 2.5. And then you have to be a person of good character and understand our core values, how we operate and respect the sport. And thirdly, I'll make you a good player if you're going to stay 4 years with us. So we have players of all skill sets. We have players from entry level all the way up to what I consider to be low-end pros presently on the team. We have about 30 team members. The school supports it first class, and Ray can testify that we have a first-class arena that they custom built. It's almost a year old now.
That's it's amazing. Really nice, well kept. Great environment to learn the game in.
Prem has a little bit of a snooker background, so when I met him, he already had some experience at snooker, not hardly any at pool, but he's a very serious young man, works hard on his game. I'm certain this is the biggest match he's ever played in his life, so I'm sure there's adrenaline's coursing through his veins. I've got some electricity here.
And do you all work with the players on how to deal with that mm-hmm. adrenaline?
We do. We have the Lindenwood shooting system, and whenever you're nervous, uncertain, lack of confidence, you rely upon those chosen, selected ideals of stroke mechanics. It's pretty interesting, and we encourage that. We reinforce it every practice, and then right before we came in here today, we talked about what we were doing. Great shot there by Nick Varner. Great shot.
Yeah, sure was. The cue ball tried to trickle out from behind the six ball there. I think Nick had intended to stick it right on the six ball. He still came out okay.
Yeah, it was a great job. He was at an awkward angle to make that hit. He had to land pretty heavy on the object ball. You know, when you talk about all-around talents of the sport, you have to include Nick Varner's name if you include the disciplines, the various disciplines. And if you didn't include his name, you would just be wrong. That's all there is to it.
Absolutely. Great one-pocket player. Great nine-ball player. Great all-around player, right?
Let's talk about Banks and straight pool. There's nobody going to beat him at those either.
That's right.
Now, I don't know about his billiards game, but I suspect that would be good too. And you know what? He does it with tenacity. He thinks his shots through. He's not got the prettiest stroke mechanics that you've ever seen, but he has the guy. He's the guy that wants to win worse than the other guy and will work hard.
Right.
To always at the tournament, you always see him up hitting balls and practicing. Always admired that about Nick's game. His diligence. A dedicated craftsman.
Really great person too. Nick's always on the front lines of helping anyone.
Well, helping the sport by attending this event 2 years in a row. So,
that's right.
I mean, that says it all. He gives back to the college level, and don't think my kids weren't super excited to possibly play against a Hall of Famer.
If someone listening out there maybe wanted to try to get their college or their university to get involved in a program, what would you recommend? I mean, how as far as approaching them? I know you were approached by Lindenwood, that's rare, though. That's rare that a college would do that.
Yeah, I think still there's, the old, some of the resistance to the sport really being a sport. They think of it as a game. And, based on the fact that oftentimes it's played in bar rooms with smoke and beer, it kind of lends itself to the wrong element. But if many of the schools already have facilities that are underutilized, but they really don't have anyone there to kind of motivate the thing.
And a lot have just clubs. They have pool clubs instead of an actual team.
Yeah, at the best. I mean, usually a club is just two or three players that like it. So it really takes someone that really, you got to be kind of willing to sacrifice to make it happen. You got to love the sport. But if we did have some of those dedicated people, I know the colleges would be on board if they really took a good look at the program. And now that we have kind of a pilot program here to look at, I certainly understand a lot more about it. Okay, Shane McMinn has now won this set over Stephen Wyatt.
No kidding. Wow, he came back from behind. And Shane is a grinder.
Yeah, that was a good win. He was down 2-0. And we now have Jaden Hergott coming up on the secondary table.
Mark, I believe we have had a score here already. And I still have the score at 0, or perhaps they have not.
No, still, opening rack.
Still first rack. Players are keeping track of their games with coins. Thank you. we are back, and we'll look, get the score updated here. I believe Nick Varner may be up 1-0. You know what, actually, I think he did not mark his game there, and I believe it is 1-1. Nice bank from Nick there. Once again, joining us, Mark Wilson here, a coach of the Lindenwood Billiard Team. And this is your host, Ray Hansen. We're back live from the Durbin Farms here in central Illinois.
Yep, we're playing some nine ball today. And Nick Varner was trailing 1-0, and his opponent was shooting the nine. Prem was shooting the nine, missed it. Nick stepped up, rifled in a great bank shot, tied the match up, broke, made a ball, and now he's got a killer safety down. That's the kind of turnaround you have when you play a Hall of Famer. A missed shot like that can cost you 2 or 3 games, you know, which would be the whole set in this case.
Now Nick has got him locked down.
He's going to need top spin is not the greatest way to go at this one. But he was able to hit it, so that being the case, I thought he needed to shorten it up a little bit more.
There's no easy shot here for Nick, a little tester. He'll likely go over into the side rail just above the side pocket here and back out just a touch for the three ball, take a long shot of the three ball.
Yeah, that would seem to be the shrewd play. Minimize cue ball travel, take what you have. That's what the table wants to give you. Beautiful. But it was a nice pace that gave himself a little bit of extra accuracy there. When you feel that first shot of each inning, your arm's a little shaky, you want to make sure you get the ball down. Let the cue ball drift out to the center of the table, the most valuable position area on the entire table.
All right, and right here, he's got the entire table. He's okay on, but he would like to be below the line from the four ball to the corner pocket. He would like to be below that line. Just a hair if possible, so he can avoid the eight ball. But it's not the end of the world if he comes off the eight ball, is it?
No, and the main thing is don't miss the three, trying to be cute and preserve the right angle there. It's not really, it's a little bit thin for the shot, and I think he's feeling uncomfortable about trying to slow roll this. So. Get a lot of experience here with Nick Varner, very savvy veteran. Yeah, played it with a nice pace. He is going to have to deal with the eight ball, but made sure he made the three. That's always a good decision. Make sure you make the ball. 1-1 is their score. Big rack here.
Yeah, it looks like he could use the eight ball. The edge of the eight ball here just has kind of like a pseudo rail. And come off the eight ball into the bottom rail, back up towards the five. Doesn't really have to have a lot of angle on this five ball.
What a nice shot that was. Well played, well controlled.
Right back out to the center of the table.
Looking at whether trying to hold the cue ball for one cushion position or two cushion position. He now goes across the table to see about playing the six in the far long corner pocket. Comes out for the side pocket. Well done.
Well, there are a lot of players may have just floated straight over and played the shot in the bottom left corner there. And Nick's route here seems like he took the, made sure he had an easier shot on a six ball by coming around and playing for the side pocket.
Yeah, it wasn't so much the shot on the six ball. He wasn't worried about making it in the corner, but that led him to position easier transfer. If he fell funny or straight on the six, he wouldn't have to draw it. So by getting out here, it allowed him to get on the eight ball a little bit easier. Good shot. Falls perfectly on the nine. Hits the heart of the pocket. And now the missed nine ball has now turned into two games the other way. As Nick's capitalized. And that's what an unforced error does in pro pool. Oftentimes it accumulates two or three games.
Or more.
Your opponent back in.
Yeah. Well, any updates on what the current score is between the teams?
As it stands right now, Lindenwood has four matches, and the Durbin Destroyers have two. This is a race to 17 matches out of 32. We'll be playing all 32 matches, no matter what the score is, however.
Nice.
Yeah. Okay, 2-1 for Varner. Prem Karkai breaking. Good break. Successful break. Three ball kisses the one out. Like the seven ball is going to cover the cue ball, which it did, so we'll be seeing a push out from here.
That's a tough one, too. Where do you like pushing out here, Mark?
Well, with Nick Varner, I mean, if there's any way to tie up some balls and try to prolong the game, which is still not going to be necessarily a winning strategy, I just try to prolong it. But yeah, you have to push out two rails. This is a hard push out, really. You got to get the cue ball clear on the other end of the table and try to hope that you don't leave a on-angle bank.
Right.
Eight ball's kind of in the way. Tricky, tricky, tricky situation.
I'm curious to see what Prem is going to come up with here.
Well, he's not calling push out. Yes, he is. He may have scratched on this. Nope. Good. Yeah, well done. It was actually a good shot just for a push-out. He had to make a good shot.
Yeah, he sure did.
He left the on-angle bank, though. Nick will accept this because he can tuck the cue ball underneath the two. And if the one ball finds the pocket, he's got to play on the two. If it doesn't, he's going to leave it very difficult for Prem. No risk, just tuck the cue ball away. Well done. Makes me want to applaud here, even though I'm the coach of Lindenwood. That was a great shot. That was a lesson right there, really. Yeah. Hope my players were watching. On the adjacent table here, John Gabriel broke, made the nine on the break, but that returns to the table. It just counts as a ball down. You do not win or lose on the nine ball on the break. Ray, these matches are going to end up on YouTube?
Yes.
Well, that's the great thing about this. Now my players can go back and look, and when they see the shot that Nick Varner just played right there, now you know why he's in the Hall of Fame. Analyzed it, didn't take too much risk. He could have banked at the one. He already made a great bank in this match.
Right. The two ball wasn't real big to hide behind there.
Right.
If he had trickled out and left a shot, he may have sold out the game.
In these little short races to three, you can't be giving up open innings, you know, so this was very heady. And he's got the upper hand in this right here. He just needs one game to collect the match. Prem's got the jump cue out. Oh, good job. Good job. He made a legal hit. He's left a shot, but that's all he could do from there. And Varner has earned another good opening here with his stellar safety play. Yeah, that's courtesy of the Gold Crown 5 Tour Edition with super snug pockets in there. He did not hit that ball bad.
These tables come from the factory with 4.5-inch pockets.
Yeah, beautiful setup here. This arena is unbelievable here at Durbin's Q Factory, isn't it?
Yes, it's beautiful.
Who would imagine? I've known Nick for a lot of years and always admired his game and his composure. And you know, in Efren's prime, nobody went to the Philippines and beat Efren Reyes in a long set except for Nick Varner.
No kidding.
Yep. Wow. Beat him a 3-day set. Yeah, it was a very, very interesting match.
I know Efren has a lot of respect for Nick.
Bad luck there. That was a heck of a try at the 9.
Well, I take it the 1 must not have went in. I thought he had the 1. He could have spun the cue ball off the end rail and made that 1 ball.
He may have been trying that, hit it too heavy. And much like you alluded to earlier, he's a bit nervous in this match. I'm not sure. It's hard to tell from our angle because we're so low, but it may have been making room. Okay. Well, on the other match we have... John Gabriel has just collected the win, so the score now in the entire match is 4 for Lindenwood, 3 for the Destroyers.
We're going to do a quick rundown here of the players that are playing on each team here.
And for the Lindenwood Lions, we have Shariq Syed, one of our team leaders.
Where is Shariq from?
He's from Singapore. Okay. Came here exclusively for the billiards program.
Mm-hmm.
And he's a 4.0 honors student. Got the Presidential Scholarship Award, which is really a cool thing. And then we have Tanner Nichols. He's from the middle of Missouri. Landon Chuffett hails from Kentucky. He's the current reigning men's national collegiate billiards champion.
Yeah, very impressive young man.
Right behind him, we have Brianna Miller, and she's the current women's national champion. She's from Pennsylvania. Then we have Stephen Wyatt from Kentucky, Drake Niepater from Albers, Illinois, Prem Karkai from Nepal. He's playing Nick Varner here in front of us now, and then Jaden Hergott from Minnesota. On the opposition's team, they are led by Nick Varner. We don't have to say much about him. Hall of Famer. John Gabriel from Oklahoma. Pro player. Great player.
Our host.
Our host. The namesake here. He's now playing a match against Shariq.
Mike Durbin. Great cues also, by the way.
Great person. And we have...
You've been playing with Mike's cues for quite a few years, haven't you?
Sure have, yeah. And does a tremendous job and willing to try new things. Always pioneering new ways to make the cues better.
Yeah, that's awesome.
They're very performance-oriented. They're cosmetically beautiful, but he doesn't overdo that part of it if it mitigates the performance characteristics of the cue. So I always admired that about him.
Yeah, I'm anxious to hit a few balls with one. I've never hit with one.
Then we have Chuck Ralston.
No, Chuck was in the, he was in the, played in the Junior Nationals also. Did Chuck win a Junior Nationals? I can't recall. It's
caught me off guard there. I'm not sure if he did or didn't. I know he's played in all these.
Yeah, it's been 10 or 12 years since that.
Nick Varner closes out the match. The other players would be Shane McMahon from Oklahoma and Dustin Wilgus from here in Champaign, Illinois. So they got a formidable lineup.
Yeah, they got a solid team.
And so,
all right, we're going to get that one saved, Mark. Thanks for those rosters. And we'll be back with another match here momentarily. Looks like, well, we'll announce who we're going to have here in just a moment. Don't go away, folks.
Yeah, Chuck and Tanner.